call. Everybody is here. Additions to the agenda, I think Linda sent out two additionals, number five under consent and one underneath personnel. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And adopt the adoption of the agenda.
So moved.
We got a motion from Cheryl.
Second.
Second from Bruce. Any other further discussions? Hearing none, all in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Approve, same sign, and approve. District 741 is proud of. There's nothing underneath that for tonight. Public comment, again, nothing underneath that. And then approve and correct the minutes from the July 18th, 2017 regular school board meeting.
I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes.
So I got a motion from Bruce.
Second.
Second from Randy. Any other further discussions? Hearing none, all in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, and carried. Consent agenda. We have five underneath the consent agenda. The first one is review and consider resignation from Karen Hemekovic, a custodian effective August 8th, 2017. Review and consider approval of hiring Caitlin Blumker, PAS site leader, effective August 14th, 2017 for 7.75 hours per day during the school year. Number three, we have a review and consider the following athletic assignments for the 2017-18 school year. We have head cross-country coach, Christine Weifels, assistant cross-country coach is Jeff Swatsky. Head volleyball coach is Nicole Humbert. Assistant volleyball coach is Kelly Kleinschnitz. Ninth grade volleyball coach is Jen Welly. Junior high volleyball, Jackie Spanier and Bill Hess. Head football coach, Max Maher, and assistants football would be Ron Fuchs, Chad Campbell, Todd Spanier. Ninth grade coach for football would be Ben Borgener. And then junior high football would be Brad Skuglin, Phil Carlson, and Tracy Pietenberg. Review and consider following non-athletic assignments. Instrumental music and high school jazz band and middle school jazz band would be Thorin Knowlton. Yearbook would be Katrina Miller. Middle school three-act play would be Jennifer Wirtz. Vocal music is Cheryl Bungham. And then we have student council high school and middle school. And there's a variety of half times, which is Kelly Whaler, Jackie Campbell, Don Knoll. And FFA is Natalie Utch. Pops Choir is Cheryl Bungham. Prom is open. School patrol is split between Diana Schultz and Audra Lura. National Honor Society is open. And then the musical three-act play, Cheryl Bungham and Cheryl Strand. And then for number five, review and consider Christina Hachacha, 0.6 FTE teacher, effective August 28th, 2017, contingent upon her receiving her Minnesota teacher's license. So those are all underneath the consent agenda.
Yeah, for the last one, she's a just graduated teacher, so we're waiting for MDE to process the licensure, but we do want to make that contingent, and we certainly want to thank Karen for all of her time that she has been at District 742.
How long has she been with us?
I'm thinking about 24, 25 years, do we know?
How long? Karen?
Did she?
Yeah, it's about 23 years, I think.
23?
Yeah, I remember. Trying to think when
she just got a fourth.
Yep.
I'll make a motion to approve the consent agenda.
I'll second.
So I got a motion from Bruce and a second from Rick. Any other further discussions? Hearing none, all in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, and carried. So we're going to move on to business. We're going to move on to number one, which is review and consider approval of the elementary school faculty handbook for the 2017-18 school year. Should have been in your packet. Dave, do you have anything for that?
Well, actually, I do. The bullying policy that's in all of the handbooks that I have, it has a different format than the policy that we have in the high school one, and also the one that's on file in our, in each school. I think the formatting may have happened when we switched to Google or something and automatically changed something. So it's difficult to read and seems very long, so we will reform that. And the wording and everything is the same, it's just how it's set up. And so we'll take care of that tomorrow. So that's a major change that we had. And I thank Bruce for taking the time to read the one and noticing that. So we'll make that change tomorrow.
Okay.
I'll make a motion to approve the elementary school faculty handbook with the change of the bullying procedure so it reads in outline form.
Okay. So you got a motion from Bruce.
I'll second.
Second from Cheryl. Any other further discussions? Hearing none, all in favor signify by aye.
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 Opposed, same sign. And carried. Number two, review and consider approval of the elementary student parent handbook for the 2017-18 school year.
Again, this contains the bullying policy that I'll reformat.
Okay.
I'll make a motion to approve the elementary student parent handbook pending the same change.
Second.
With the bullying policy.
So I got a motion from Bruce, a second from Rick. Were you going to say anything more or no? Okay. All right.
Just answering questions.
All in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. And carried. Number three, review and consider approval of the district's paraprofessional handbook for the 2017-18 school year.
Any questions on? With the student handbook and the paraprofessional handbook this year, in the spring we had a committee that met and really went through all of the handbooks, and a lot of things were outdated and needed to be changed. And so there was a lot more changes than there was in the previous years. So,
okay, I'll make the same motion.
Okay. So I got a motion from Lou.
Same motion. I think that has the bullying in it too. So that'll just be changed accordingly.
Yep. So I got a motion from Lou and a second from Bruce. Any other further discussions? Hearing none, all in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. And carried. Number four, review and consider approval designating this Paynesville Area School Superintendent Robert Hewitt with authority to authorize user access to the Minnesota Department of Education MDE secure website and give the superintendent the responsibility to assigning jobs duties to local education agency staff.
Yeah, this is an annual thing that we have to do for MDE. Once the board approves this, then I copy this agenda and send it to MDE so they're aware that the board approved it, and then we go about what we've done for the last 5 years. So
I move.
I'll second.
So I got a motion from Rick and a second from Bruce. When it's written as local education agency staff, is that just our school staff?
It's virtually our school staff that we give it. Well, it's a little bit more than just school staff. It could be anybody that has to do something for our group.
Okay.
For instance, they're, you know, the WCED, there are certain things that they need to be able to get cleared for to do.
Okay.
I have the authority to be able to clear any organization that needs the information from us. I have the ability to give them approval to get that.
Okay. That makes more sense, okay. Any other further discussions? Hearing none, all in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, and carried. Number five, review and consider approval of the EMPA, which is the Educational Minnesota Paynesville School, 2017 through 2019 master agreement, so that would be their contract.
Correct. This is the first contract that's coming to, at the next meeting, I'm hoping to have a few more contracts, but that they still have to get approved, we have tentative agreements. So I'm going to kind of walk through the board on this one. There are a number of changes as far as just dates and times, but if you take a look at page 11, one page or piece on that was under section 2, early childhood. You'll see that we took out and scratched out teachers and preschool readiness teachers. Those teachers will now go to their actual contract. Being attached to this, they follow the early childhood piece. Now they will just follow the contract like all the other teachers. On the very back, I think it's the just about the back page, there's a memorandum of understanding that also goes with this on page 58. That says that we're just doing this for 2 years. We're doing it for 2 years just to make sure that the district doesn't find any glitches or issues that it creates by putting that group into the regular contract, but also gives the teachers a chance to see if it causes any issues for them. So it's a 2-year referendum. If things go well, then the memorandum of understanding will disappear for the next contract. All right, then if you go to page 21, it talks about seniority and some things are struck out there, and you can see that. That is language that really wasn't needed anymore because we don't have any staff that fall under that category. Then under page 23, eligibility, under subdivision 1, some things were struck out, again, age discriminatory. We've certainly been recommended from MSBA to get rid of anything that refers to a specific age. So you can see that at least age, or 55 years of age, immediately eligible has been taken out, or at least 55 years of age has been taken out and added was immediately eligible to claim their TRA benefit. Doesn't really change anything, it just takes any of the piece with age discriminatory out. And then you go to page 24, and we just added, we got rid of post-retirement, we added healthcare savings plan, that's where those dollars go to. And also on subdivision 4, we added our detailed in the HCSP document, that's the healthcare savings plan document that the dollars go to for the staff. Again, nothing changes, it just cleans it up a little bit by getting rid of the rest of that, because those things are determined by that document anyway. Any questions so far? Then we're gonna go to page 29. Under family leave, we lined out a maximum of 96 hours annually will be allowed, and we added under pursuant to MS 181.9413, a teacher may use his or her accumulated sick leave and the school board limits use as permissible. Again, doesn't change anything, but it is following the law. Then we jump to page 34. And we just added section 13 and everything got bumped down then, and we just put a piece in on FMLA. We do follow it anyway, nothing has changed, but we wanted to put a piece in there that specifically showed teachers that we do follow the FMLA piece. Okay, then we go all the way to Schedule A. It should be past 42. And you have Schedule A for the 17-18 school year. And then on the back side, you have Schedule B, which then covers the 18-19 school year. Okay, the biggest changes for Schedule A besides additional dollars was that we did get rid of Step 1. Now, the reason we got rid of Step 1 is because in comparison to other districts, they're paying their first step teachers considerably more than we are. I still think we're a little behind, but we're pretty close by taking step one out, and then we added it to the end. So it remains looking the same, but in essence, we did remove step one, moved everything up and added another step, so it still remains one through 14. Okay, the only change that we made then is that we didn't add another step to 13 under BA 10 through BA plus 20. We did take one complete step away there, really doesn't change a whole lot. For the second year, then it just goes by the same schedule as that. So it's a little different in that teachers did get a step in essence, it just may not look like it on paper, and we added a piece under there, under Schedule A, that says, in 2017-19, step one salary was deleted and all steps moving up, and new salary added to step 14. Step 13 was deleted, BA plus 10, BA plus 20. Okay, so it just clarified it a little bit. Teachers didn't lose anything, they got their steps. It just, on paper, it just looks differently because we did it the way we did it. I think it was important to take away that first step because we were falling considerably behind other districts on what they were paying their beginning year teachers. They got their steps, they got their lanes, I'll give you the percentage here. The total package for the 17-18 school year with steps and lanes and everything else, and there's a little bit more attached to it, I'll tell you, was 4.34%, and for the second year was 3.25%. Now, we have to continue a little bit because the other major piece that we changed was Schedule C. There's been a number of inequities, and we've brought that to the board before, when the fact that some coaches were virtually staying the whole season, but weren't really getting compensated for it. It was a lot of hard work by a very good committee. We looked at things and we compared them to each other, and we said, okay, if this coach is putting this much time in, they should get this amount. If they're putting less time in, they should get less amount. If they're putting more time in, they should get more. So we really did equalize things considerably. I can't say it's perfect, but I know that Connie was a piece of that committee. I think we would say that it took care of quite a few of the issues that were there. So my hat is off to the committee that worked on this with me. It was not an easy piece because there were some winners and there were some losers. But I think it really did equalize things considerably and took care of some of those inequities about that. And then for the second year, we did give them about a little less than about 2% increase. Nothing has gone to Schedule C for, well, certainly not since I've been here, and I don't know when the last time any adult money was put on Schedule C. And I think part of the reason was because of those inequities. You know, so this really did clean it up, and like I said, it was a lot of hard work on a committee that we had, and it was presented to EMPA, and I'm just very grateful to making the changes. There was additional cost to the district because we made those changes. But I think, again, because Schedule C had not gotten any additional dollars for a considerable amount of time, it was long due, and you know, they've been talking about doing what that committee did for years. So we were able to get that done. So that's kind of the contract. I think it's a fair contract. And I would certainly recommend that we approve it. And I know that this has gone through the committee that worked with us to come up with this tentative agreement. Any questions on the part of the board?
I have to just say, for being on the committee, this group is a very nice group to work with. I felt that when Bob laid out where we were at as a district, what we had to do, that they also viewed the district as a whole, just like we do. And I just find it a very nice group to work with. Yeah.
I think the great thing about it is that we do listen to each other's, and because there are different points of views for this. You know, when you look at any kind of package for any group, you have to look at more than just the salary. There's benefit packages or everything when we compare them to other districts. So where you might be better off on one place, you might be considerably lower on another, and I think that's probably what will need to be looked at maybe during the next session, you know, where you look at the complete package and everything else. But I think for now, I think this is fair.
Thank you.
Just have one question, Bob.
Sure.
Just for clarification, now, when you gave these percents, you said that is a salary, but also that includes...
It includes Schedule C along with that. There is no benefits that were increased.
Okay.
The only piece is either by salary on Schedule A and B for the 2 years, but also Schedule C, because there was an increase on both years for that. There was an increase because we adjusted things and put them where they really should be. And again, during that process, there were some people that lost dollars, but understood where the committee was coming through from. And then for the second year, once we had it straightened, we did add some dollars back to Schedule C by about 2% on that schedule. Otherwise, the format of the schedule, other than placing the groups in different lanes, as you might say, the format itself remained the same. There wasn't any change. We still give a certain percentage for, depending on where they're at, none of that changed. It's just that where one group was, they might have been in a different piece when we got done looking at them and saying, because of the amount of time you put in, you really should be here or here, wherever that is. And I, along with Bruce, I would say that the group has just been very good to work with.
The nicest of that is they didn't get everything they wanted, nor did, it wasn't that there were no opinions there. We had a lot of great conversations, but it worked out really good. But what I always felt was that they were interested in the whole district. So sometimes if they had a concession, it was to benefit all of us. So I make a motion to approve this contract.
I'll second.
So I got a motion from Bruce and a second from Rick. Any other further discussions? Hearing none, all in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. And carry. Good job.
One down.
What? One down. Number six would be review and discuss next steps towards filling the superintendent position effective July 1st of 2018. As we all know, Bob Hewitt is going to be retiring at the end of this school year, so we have to start preparing for a new superintendent for our school system. So kind of open up for discussions of, you know, last time what we did, and is that something that we want to go back to doing or what? So I'm just kind of, anybody can speak about it.
I personally like the way we did it last time. Yeah. We had a community group that wasn't appointed, people who assisted in this. We had the school board group, which I wasn't on at that time. I was in the community group. We had a staff group. And the most fascinating thing to me was we all did it separate. We all did it different ways. We all had different discussions. They were all separate in their own things. But when it came right down to it, everything came up with the same result. And he's sitting right down at the end there. So I just thought it was a nice way to do it. And whenever we go to any of the conferences, they always talk about getting your stakeholders in your community involved. And this is a main thing. I just think it was a really good way to make it work. Do we know if that group does it still?
I did take the liberty to contact that person because I thought that it was Mr. Vondell that had helped mm-hmm. you before. Mm-hmm. I guess from my perspective, I would recommend a couple things. One is to have a special board meeting to discuss where you want to go so that you can take whatever time you need to decide where you want to go. Greg still does do that.
Okay.
So, you know, one option would be to bring in a number of people or just bring in Mr. Vondell to give you his proposal. But it's certainly up to the board on what direction they would like to go.
Okay. I know Mr. Vondell, when he did it 4 years or 5 years ago, it was kind of one of those things where he was a great presenter. He did a wonderful job. But one of the things we liked about it, too, is that it was cheap. Mm-hmm. So, and I know that's 5 years ago.
Well, I didn't ask him if he was cheaper or not.
He was cheaper. He was cheaper than what what other people have gone through. So maybe just to do our due diligence, obviously, we can probably have him come in at least present what he has, and if there's some way that we could probably find out, I know the MSBA does the same kind of thing, just to see once where prices are, and then that'll at least give us something to talk about at that meeting, and then we can kind of make an intelligent decision on going what, but I do agree, we should go with multiple committees. I think that's essential to get all the stakeholders involved. Again, it's just a matter of who we're going to put in that lead position to get us there.
Are there any specific groups you, there's a number of groups that do superintendent searches. Do you okay. want me to limit to MSBA and Greg, or do you want me to look at other groups also?
Well, you could probably look at other, just to see what's where the prices are. I mean, that's going to really tell us a lot. I mean, we're not, I mean, I don't know if we want to spend $50,000 on a firm to go look for something when.
Some of the other firms, I'm not sure, I know that some of the other firms do very big districts.
Yeah.
You know, why don't I gather some information for the board, okay. and I'll have it at once you set the special board meeting time.
Okay. Because we could bring Mr. Vandell in too as a presenter, at least sure. so that we get an idea, because we're comfortable with what he's done in the past, and then at least gives us an idea what his thought process is about, and then we'll obviously get kind of an idea what he'll charge us to.
Okay. So. Well, I'll invite Greg to this meeting. I think because you had him before, I think it's probably one you want certainly want to look at. And I'll set that up. Any timeline you guys want me to look at as far as setting up that special board meeting, sooner than later?
I like things that we plan a long time, and this is just the beginning of the planning. I think is sooner the better as far as I'm concerned. So we can plan it. We're not
because they'll be here before
scrambling
we know
at the last minute and making some decision that we probably should have thought about more. So,
and then this will give us an idea of getting the word out to other superintendents that potentially could be candidates for this position, give them early enough notification that we're looking so that we might have a bigger pool to select from. So,
well, I think whoever you decide to go with, and I do think that's a good idea, will have an idea about your timeline, mm-hmm. you know, that you need to, when you need to get things in to yep. to get your best possible pool of candidates.
Yep. And Greg did that last time for us. Mm-hmm. He kind of laid it all backwards. He started from the beginning and or from the end result all the way back, and then this is where we should be starting at that date. So that he'd give us a great idea of when that all should take place. So.
So it looks like our first meeting in September is on the 12th. Right now, you guys have a lot of stuff to get ready for school to get mm-hmm. started and open and stuff, plus anybody else that's got stuff going on. Is it possible? I know that one time we did those special board meetings before our regular meeting. We'd have it like 5 o'clock or something, and our regular meeting's at 6. I thought we did that a couple of times, and that, it can be separate. I don't
the only,
care.
The only, I guess I, the only thing I don't like about maybe about that is that if there is somebody in the community that want to be here, that might
that's
be
true.
Too early for them. Mm-hmm. Because it is open to anybody, and if there's some stakeholders that are out there that knowing that we're going to start searching, we'll mm-hmm. probably have some people in the community that would be here. And
well, the 19th of September is between our September board meetings.
My only concern with that would be the gala and what we oh, need to yeah. do to set up for the gala.
Yeah.
When is
got
the gala?
That in
gala's on the 23rd.
Okay.
Okay, let's go back a little bit.
So quite frankly, I'd either like to do it earlier in August or wait till after the gala is over.
What does everybody else think?
I think we should do it in August.
Okay,
so
we
too.
Could do that.
Fine with me.
Get things started.
Yeah, and it's. I think it's fine from our point of view. Mm-hmm. You know, we just have the normal things set up now for opening workshops and those types of things. So other than our August 22nd board meeting, you know, and the facility meeting. So just be aware that you've got that also coming up. Why don't I try to find a date that will work? I will text you and we will set a date. for when that meeting will be. And there will only be one agenda item, you know, as a special board meeting, we just need to have to very clearly put it out, and will be something generic as far as determining the process to follow for hiring a new superintendent.
And Mark, you were thinking around 6 o'clock, or are you thinking later?
No, I would say around 6.
Seems to work out pretty good.
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll find a time for around 6 o'clock to do that sometime in August if we can, because I do think it's important to have all board members present for that one.
Yeah, and it would be nice to be able to get that in the paper, though, since we're not setting it today, to get it in the paper so that they can...
We have a thumbs up for the paper, so...
Okay, I mean, so we have to correlate it.
So, well, and we have to post at least three days, so it won't be before next Wednesday for sure, and that's when the paper will come out with a piece on this.
Just so that if somebody's interested in it already, they can come to it. Okay?
Okay, so I will find a time to set up a meeting. It'll be at 6 o'clock, and we'll try to get one set in August.
Okay.
And I will try to find a date that also Mr. Vondell is available for that meeting.
Yeah.
And I'll check with MSBA also, you know, if they want to send somebody to that meeting also. I'll see what I can find out from some other groups that do this.
Well, just so we have kind of a couple, few people so we know what prices anyhow, so that, and I'm sure Greg is really reasonable, but I guess we should just still look at what prices are for my videos.
Nope, I think that's a fair thing to ask.
Okay, all right, so there's no motion that needs to be done on that?
Nope, I will just follow the direction of the board.
Okay, all right, so we're going to move on to personnel. Mark Dingman will provide a summary of the superintendent's evaluation. Last board meeting, we went into closed session for the evaluation piece for the superintendent, Bob Hewitt, and kind of there's a lot of discussions about a lot of things that he has done over the course of not necessarily just the year, but just some of the things that he's highlighted for his whole tenure here. Some of the goals that he had accomplished this year were distinguished. I think last year I put together an overall end of summary evaluation that I'm going to give to Bob tonight, and this is basically from a collaboration from everybody here that when we had went through the evaluation a couple weeks ago. And basically we just rated it from 1 to 4, 1 being unsuccessful and 4 being distinguished. And basically there was three goals that we kind of Bob Hewitt had on his radar for this last year, and all three of them he met and exceeded the expectation of the board. He had some personal goals that he was trying to do himself that he also has somewhat made to the best of his ability. There's always things that one thing was nice about us for as a board member is he's harder on himself than we could ever be on him. So when I say that, you know, if he would have rated himself, he would probably fall in that 3 or 2 range, but I did give him a 4 because I think, like I said, we all agree that he is more harder on himself than what we can ever be on him. So again, I think he's done an outstanding job for this district this past year. And then the overall rating is, you know, a 4, which is distinguished. Some of the things that were commented on, you know, while we were talking about different things, and, you know, he is still only one person that holds a big responsibility for the district. I know he's got a lot of administrators, but he's still kind of one of those administrators that still likes to have his fingers in almost everything. So, you know, we try, even as I think as his own staff, his own administrators, his own personal staff at the district office has basically had reminded him timeless and timeless again that, you know, that they can help do different things, and they're willing to step up to the plate and help whenever possible, even the other staff. But you know, so those are some of the things that we talked about, you know, that wish we could, you know, he could delegate more, but he doesn't. And I think the last evaluation, he basically, we alluded to the same thing, that, you know, he has a hard time delegating his responsibility because he feels like he has to be the one that has to do it. But again, we've gone farther than what I guess what we all expected, you know, with the budget being the way it is today, the contracts, I mean, every contract that he has negotiated for us in the last couple of years, and especially this year going around, yeah, it'd be nice because we have a little bit more money to do that. It always helps to settle contracts and stuff like that. But he did, you know, present that, you know, we have the money, so he was willing to share that with his staff and to get them to a better place where, you know, that we can be a better community orientated school. So he still needs to work on some of the policies and procedures, and then also some of the evaluations. Again, one of those things where evaluations is kind of one of always kind of the last thing that we all think of, because there's so many other things that we're trying to do for the kids and stuff like that, but we still have to remind them as the board that some of these things have to get done. So we did kind of, you know, allude to that, you know, the policy and procedure and the evaluations need to be get done so that we can continue on being as good as we are today. So in a nutshell, a very good review from everybody on the board. He's going to be missed immensely. You know, after he's retired, he's got some big shoes to be filled, but he will be in a, hopefully his wife will accept them back into his house. If anybody knows Bob, he's here from sun up to sundown and even past the sundown. He's at every activity. He wants to be involved with his school, and he has shown that timeless and time again. So I'm just hoping that he can turn off the key at some point in time and have a fruitful retirement, and we all bid him the best for these next couple of years and stuff like that. So thanks again, Bob, for everything you've done. This last year for us, it's been a wonderful year for everybody involved. So with that note, thank you. All right, so we have some informational reports. We have Lori Flora for the secondary principal report.
All right, Bob, if I can have you go to your email, and you should have two things I just sent you.
Okay, as long as you just sent them to
me. Yep, I just sent you. I had an exciting couple weeks. One thing that I did with our students, we had about 9 students involved, that went to a VEX Robotics camp up at St. Cloud State, or St. Cloud Tech. And the camp was a week long. I went and was there probably about half the time to find out what the VEX Robotics was about and how a team would work and kind of see what some of the costs are and that type of thing. It was exciting. I am thrilled. Oh, can you flip that one?
I don't know.
Maybe not. Go to the next one. And our kids did very well. They had 5 days to put together a robot. And many of the robots, this is at the Benton County Fair. We had the 9 kids put together 2 robots. St. Cloud let us keep one of the robots intact to go compete at the fair. Many of the robots that the kids competed against have been, the kids have been working on them for a year. So one they used during the season and then kind of continued to work on them. So our students did very well. They did everything from the building to programming, the coding, figuring out the game and the strategy. to actually competing. They ended up fourth in the qualifying rounds and then ended up in the semifinals, which then we were beat out. But you'll see, go ahead and click the arrow. The nature of the game this year, the game changes every year. So what happens is the robots go, and those short pylons, the yellow ones get stacked on the red and the blue, and the robots have to figure out, are they running? Mm-hmm. Or did they get, oh, he's talking. The robots have to figure out how to put them on. Oh, right now, this was the autonomous, and this is without driver control. They get 2 points if they can move it forward and park in the red or the blue square. Now the kids are driving them, and they have to try to put those pylons on the tall stack or the short ones, and then you'll see in the corner there's zones. So there's like a 5 point, 10 point, 20 point zone. Our robot is the one going after that tall, mobile, blue stack there. And that was, ours was really good at getting the cones on the tall stack. We had a little bit of a strength problem. We couldn't pull as much weight into the zone, but it was a great learning experience in listening to our students talk about coding and how they would have done things differently. And there's a strategy here too. There's defense and offense because you are working with another team's robot. You'll see how that one could just scoop up that red pylon and bring it over to that corner. And we could drag it, but we couldn't get it over that next zone in the corner, which was 10 points, which was kind of cool. As you see, that is the stage. Every year, that is basically the field they play on, and then every year the game is different, so the coding of the robot changes, etc. But it was exciting, and we have lots of interest in our high school students. You'll see Mr. Heft there is the one who's controlling, but his team members, like Mr. Nichols, is kind of saying, this is what so-and-so is doing, because only the tallest stack in each zone wins. So if somebody has two cones on, like the red stack, then you wouldn't get any points. But it was really neat. As we're moving forward, you'll hear me bring it up again. I hope this is something we can bring on a more formal basis to Paynesville. I think we would have both at the high school, middle school, and probably even elementary level, a lot of interest. And obviously I was talking to a couple parents that work here in Paynesville with different industries saying, oh, there is all of these things. This is what industry is. Mm-hmm. You know, it's coding, it's problem solving, it's collaborating, it's all of these things. And he's like, and I said, and it's in game form. Well, it has to be in game form. Mm-hmm. You know, so the parents that were there with us were very excited as well. So if nothing else, it's something that we can certainly look at encouraging our students and maybe even providing transportation through some different funding for this week-long camp. But you'll hear me bring it up again because it was a wonderful experience. The AccuPlacer, I also gave this last week. Our students taking concurrent courses have to take the college entrance test. So I did offer that a couple times. I have a couple students that didn't make when we gave it, so I'll be administrating it again in a couple weeks once I talk to the college to get an appeal to open it up again. But with vacations and some different things, not everybody was able to make it in during the time that we gave it, but students worked hard at it. We're also finished up with scheduling. Registration is tomorrow. That's always a busy day. I would like to congratulate both my assistants as well as our elementary. They actually got the online registration up and running. And from what I've heard, it's been very user-friendly from parents. And now tomorrow we'll see how that helps with some of the chaos and the collecting of papers and stuff, because we're seeing that to be very minimal. Mm-hmm. Parents that haven't done it online, we will have that available with help and support in the cafeteria as well, so they will have a chance to do it there. But from what I've heard, just out in the public, it's pretty smooth. Then we had our technology conference today that we're in a team with seven other districts, held at Recori today. We had just over 20 teachers, I think, there, doing a variety of different sessions from Google School to Lockout to several different things, technology leadership and different things on how to use technology to enhance our student learning, not just play with the gadgets, but to increase their learning. The other thing that I've been kind of working on is with the gala committee, getting demonstrations there. So as we look at possibly bringing some additional things into our career and technical areas, we do have that VEX trailer coming down with a couple robots for people to play. A laser engraver will be down there. We have a 3D printer. Today I got verified that we'll have a virtual painter, like auto body painter, and it'll show you how you do. He is going to be bringing that. And working on a virtual welder. So we kind of can give our public and our community, these are some tools that we could use to help our students try and kind of explore some of these different careers, because you know, and to raise that interest, especially at some of our younger ages or middle school, kind of mm-hmm. beginning of high school. The other thing, Bob and Bruce went with me and we toured Alexandria. Do you have some of those pictures or do you want to put them up later?
I didn't bring them for this. Well, I might be able to get it.
We can do it at the facility meeting.
Yeah.
We did take a tour. Alexandria built a new high school two mm-hmm. years ago. And we toured their CTE program, had some phenomenal things, and really gave us some ideas of what we could look at as a facility project and what could help our students become competitive in that world and just explore those careers since there's such a high need. This was the machining behind you. This they call it curbside. It opens up to their cafeteria and it's all glass windowed, and they was that the machining tool? Do you remember, Bruce? Mm. It's a little light. Or was that the metal engraver?
That was the metal engraver.
I think so.
The machining tool. I think you got another picture probably of the machining tool.
And saw a lot of different things. They do have, they built following the school, the year later they built a greenhouse. It was about $1 million project for the greenhouse.
Just for the greenhouse.
Phenomenal program, but they do use most of the vegetables to provide for the school. The kids process it. They have two classrooms, two greenhouse areas, some really good ideas for us to just use as we kind of put together our own ideas of where we want to move forward. We will be taking another tour down the road. I'd like to go visit Albany. Just recently did an expansion in that area as well. And there's a couple other auto body programs out there of things that people have. So kind of my vision is looking towards facilities for our CTE programs. And that is a virtual welder. That is what I am trying to get for our gala as well. The principal there did say that he has seen an upswing in females trying their welding classes because it gives them a chance to do the skill without the fear of the fire and all of this before they you know, kind of in practice mode, so then when they're setting them up for success. So they have seen an upswing with females in those classes as they've put in some of the virtual welding part or machines. So just some exciting things that we've done. We've kept busy over the summer. Can't believe it's already August. So, any questions for the board?
Nope.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
And you can see why it's inequity in education.
Well, it's been a busy summer at the elementary with Vacation Bible School that went on last week, and there were over 200 area students there.
284.
284, largest one so far. And then the kitchen was serving breakfast and lunch, and it looked like a regular school day in there. So that was really fun.
And they all survived.
And they all survived.
There you go.
Yes. And Paws has also been there all summer, and so it's been really busy with students. Donnie might talk about this, but the East Wing is pretty much done on the inside. So if you haven't had a chance to come over and take a look at that, stop over. I think they're going to start the siding in the next week or so, maybe. But, we've done a few other things at the elementary with our bathrooms and drinking fountains and things like that. Next week, Matt and I are meeting with our kitchen, our head cook, to talk about the addition of the Preschool Plus program and how we're going to be, because we're going to be serving more students with that program. So we're adding more students to our building, which is great. Next week, we're also, our math curriculum committee is meeting to get started on research and looking at our data with our math scores, pre-K through 5, and we'll begin the process of looking at a curriculum that best fits those needs. I have a guest speaker. The curriculum coordinator from Aitken is gonna come up and meet with us, and she's going to go through some of our data that was available and kind of give us a guide us in the process of choosing and kind of working through that. So that will be next week. Katie completed 1 year last Thursday, and so she's done a wonderful job in the office, and she stuck with us, so that's a great thing. I already emailed her about the formatting, and she got back to me already. So I have two parapositions posted that will close on Friday, and we'll get that taken care of before the next board meeting. One is an addition that we're adding for the preschool program, and one is to replace a para who left us last spring. We are right now just kind of working on things, getting ready for back to school. We've had new students trickling in every week. We've gained I think 3 kindergartners in the last week. People moving in from different areas, and so we're happy about that. And we're just working on the goals for next year and kind of gearing up.
Cool.
Any questions for me?
Okay. Thanks. Matt DeCosa.
Good evening. Many of our summer programs are ending, of course, and finishing up our fall brochure this week. That'll be mailed out to our residents on Friday, August 18th. We're currently at 95 students for our summer Camp Pause program, and they've been very busy and very active all around the area. Here's some broad summer stats so far. We have had 3,905 class hours, 1,286 registrations, 120,154 contact hours this summer. Wow. So not bad for a little Paynesville, huh?
Nope.
We're excited to offer, I talked last time about the My Robot Build summer camp. We have that this Thursday with St. Cloud Technical College. We have 18 students in that class. I think it's one of their bigger ones in the whole region that they've had. And I just put together a gala promotion video, and one of the students that's in the video, I called him today and asked if he wanted to help out, because he's really into robotics, and he's jumping on. He's going to be there helping out with the kids. And he said, who's leading it? And Lori would know, it's the main instructor from St. Cloud Technical College is coming to lead the class. So,
oh, cool.
Our student knew him, and so we're trying to continue that, you know, robotics and coding and the excitement down in the younger levels too. Part of that too is I recently attended a 3D printing workshop at St. Ben's, and so we're excited to be offering, with that grant from the Community Foundation, we have two 3D printers now in the district, and so we're going to be utilizing that for some classes coming up too. We're busy finalizing our Preschool Plus program, as you approved a hiring of our site leader for that position. At the next meeting, we'll have a staff on the site assistant will be up for approval. So we're getting that room all set, transforming that room. And we're also in the process of transforming room 157, which will be our much needed space for pause during the school year. Now we'll have those two rooms. That was the old computer lab at the elementary that wasn't used. And so David and I are working together, and that'll be used during the school for, of course, activities and groups, but then we can use it for pause. So we'll have two rooms during the school year, which will be very helpful for us. If you haven't done already, please like our Community Ed Facebook page and our district Facebook pages. We just launched those this summer. And we're excited for Fitness Center news. We're excited to offer Zumba now 3 days a week, included with membership. So we have Monday and Wednesday evenings from 6 to 7 p.m. and Saturday mornings 9 to 10. So,
good.
Any questions for me?
Great job.
Thanks.
Next on the docket is Max Maher.
I'd handed out a student parent extracurricular activity handbook. Wanted to include that as part of my report tonight, and then put it on the agenda the second meeting in August. So I'll give you a chance to read over it, and then you can approve it at the next meeting. But there's not a lot of changes, so I just took a highlighter and highlighted some of them. First one's obviously just on the cover, changed the date. Then just the main one, on page 6 that I wanted to address, which is the transportation. I should have grabbed one so I could read it word for word, but the highlighted sentence, thank you. Garrick's got me trained not to print anything more than I need, so after tonight I don't need this anymore. But the highlighted sentence is an addition, or a proposed addition, to the transportation. So it reads, with prior approval from the activities director, a parent or legal guardian may consent to allow his or her student to ride home from an event with another adult. And the practicality of that, I guess, is that, number one, the district has a legal duty under the law to provide adequate transportation. So if we didn't provide transportation and someone got in an accident, we would be found negligible for that, because we have a duty, that's what the court of law would say, to provide transportation. I'm not an expert on the law, but we don't have, in my understanding, a duty to enforce that somebody rides, if that makes sense. We don't allow somebody, you can see earlier, we do allow a student to ride under special circumstances. They come from a funeral or something like that. But we don't allow somebody to participate if they drive on their own without prior approval. So if your son misses the bus or daughter or whatever, sorry, that's just the way it is, because of not wanting to allow them to drive on their own. However, we allow a parent to take them. So it's just, I get a lot of questions or people asking. A big one that we had this past spring is, there's a softball game in Minnewaska and there's a baseball game under the lights afterwards. If you can figure out, the softball girls want to stay after, right? And so You know, we have a situation where a kid may be riding home with their aunt who's staying to watch one or the other, and the reality of it is the practicality of also being a good steward to the families and to the people who are involved in it. In my opinion, it's something that I can manage by doing that, because they need prior approval. So how it works in any other scenario is I would contact the coach and say, hey, these people have approval, or they've contacted me, to give them a heads up. And or if a parent is with their student at the game, I mean, the coach isn't gonna be like, no, you need to get on the bus, you can't take your own kid, right? So a parent either goes up or we contact them. But if I get Mark, your daughter Caitlin brings in a note and says, I'm going to be leaving or whatever, I'll contact that parent to make sure, just so that I know that the note wasn't manufactured on their own. And so that's how we would handle that situation. So if a student comes in and they're going to be leaving with somebody else's parent or something, there's going to be contact to that parent in order to allow it to happen. I wanted to bring this up as part of our report so that, you know, if Bob wants to check on the legality or you guys want to make sure on that, but I'm pretty sure it's okay, and it's certainly something that's manageable. Just from the practicality standpoint, it just makes sense. It's common sense where, I don't know if anybody has any initial questions or response on it. So as long as something to think about. And
I guess my only response is I hope it wouldn't get out of hand, because that's a lot of extra work to put on you to have to check every kid.
I
would assume most kids are still going to ride the bus.
Exactly. And
the coaches encourage them to
in general, they do. Yeah. Yep, absolutely. So, I mean, but inevitably something comes up from time to time, and it's, you know, that particular day I had, you know what I mean? But it's not a... it's not a high volume thing where it becomes a huge issue. Otherwise, I wouldn't even be proposing to say, hey, let's look at this, because, yeah, I can't manage a phone call from every kid that's out for a sport to not ride the bus. But we enforce that they have to ride the bus there, so they have to get home somehow. They can't just ride home with a friend that's there or whatever. So, yeah, it's just kind of a special circumstance or unique situation. So, I mean, that was kind of the main thing that I wanted to discuss. Are we over time?
No, we're going to be fine. In fact, I'll mention in front of everybody that there are no elections. We moved this meeting to 5 o'clock just in case there were elections that would affect us, but there are no elections, so we're good to go.
Man, I got
you can speak.
I got a lot of stuff then. No, basically, we're gearing up. Start of fall sports seasons is August 14th, so that's a week from this past Monday. So I'm about said goodbye to my house in the daylight hours. So does anybody have any questions for me?
Thanks. Facilities, Donnie Mayer.
Well, we're looking good as far as the windows go. We're ahead of schedule there. They are going to touch up the paint inside tomorrow. And we do have the custodians already have cleaned three of the carpets. So we're just kind of following along with them. And there should be, we're going to do a punch list probably next week on the inside. So we'll finalize that. And like Dave was mentioning, the steel should come in next week. Should. That's what they're predicting, so they hope to start by Tuesday. Other than that, we did put some partitions in over at the elementary school in the fourth, fifth grade boys' bathroom that needed it. We put new faucets. Well, we're putting new faucets in both bathrooms on that end. Cleaning crew, custodians did great. Well, we're on a roll. We should be ahead of schedule on cleaning all the rooms, hallways, and should be hopefully just looking at cleaning windows and stuff the last week. And other than that, I haven't got anything else, I guess.
Cool. Thank you.
Thanks, Donnie.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else?
Just the administrative negotiations for Bruce and support staff negotiations.
I don't have any of that.
It's on the next page after. All the way down.
Oh, is that where it was? I turned mine off. I figured it got missed on the report, so I don't even have it. So it's administrative report. That we just started, communicated with everybody, and Bob's kind of working out some details, and that should come forward here pretty quick.
I guess the same would be with the support staff.
Yep, same thing with the support staff.
Okay. Administrator report, Robert Hewitt.
Just a few things. I would agree with Donnie. I think the custodians have done a great job getting our buildings ready. Starting to look really good. Still some work to get done, so we're just continuing to get ready. Again, just a reminder to the public that we are able to go past 6 o'clock because there were no elections. We had put this meeting down at 5 o'clock just in case there were, but there are none, and we checked on that today, so we're good to go past 6 o'clock. Be aware that they're in the process of building our solar gardens that we had subscribed to way back when. They're saying that this should be done in August. So we'll see. But that's what they're telling me. Gates are up. I know that you guys have gotten some calls, some against, some for. We're going to continue to monitor that. We have noticed that some people are driving around those gates, which will probably force us, particularly at the softball field, to put some additional posts in to prevent that from happening, because particularly at the softball field, we do not want people driving around those gates. Mm-hmm. You know, we want that to be more secure. And then we'll have to decide what we're going to do by the reserve center. It's a little more complicated there. There's a bigger area that if we're going to put posts in, it'd just be more of them. At one time, they used to have the post or something there to prevent people from doing that. So we'll continue to monitor, and again, as school starts, as I've said before, we'll monitor the situation and make decisions based on that. They've already talked about the elementary school windows in, so that's coming along. Negotiations are coming along. Hopefully, we'll get some of those taken care of by the next board meeting. A reminder that the next facility meeting is on August 16, 6 o'clock at the Elementary School Media Center. One topic, and that's really to decide what kind of plan or what kind of project we would do if the board were to decide to do a project. So that's the one agenda item for that. We're starting to work on the gala. Lori gave you a great some information on what we're bringing in. Just as a reminder that the gala is for 2017. The school is the main focus for that gala. We're partnering with them. It's on September 23rd at Lewis Industries. So we'd certainly encourage people to either become or buy tickets to attend that particular event. Theme is to create a spark and ignite the possibilities. And again, the main focus from our point of view is CT type of things, which would include the robotics that Lori showed today. One-to-one initiative, board members, just make sure that you bring your Chromebooks in. We're going to exchange them. We have the new Chromebooks in. The staff, we're going to start to get them, I believe, next week. So at the next board meeting on the 22nd, you will get your new Chromebook. So please bring yours to that meeting so we can exchange them. They'll be collecting the other ones. As mentioned, registration's tomorrow night, August 9th, from 3 to 7 at the high school. Some information. Donnie and I went and looked at the hospital, and they're redoing their roofs, but they're not tearing the old roof off. They're just cleaning the roof and rolling a new kind of roof on it. It's like painting a new piece to the roof. Mm-hmm. Found it real interesting. As we start to do roof projects, we'll at least look at that. I've mentioned to the architect that we've worked on, he's going to do some checking to see what he thinks of that. But it might be a much more economical way for us to go. It might be very cost efficient. Let's see what else. Recori was a great event for technology. It really did they did a good job, and I think that's a great thing for our piece. The summer lunch program's going well. MCA scores came out. I think we'll do a report to the board that goes over those. I think, like it has always been, there's some things we're doing great, there's some things that we're doing okay, and there's some things that we need to continue to work on. So we'll get that information out to the board. I think that's all I have.
Okay. Any other board sharing?
Motion to adjourn.
Okay. So I got a motion from Lou and a second from Rick. Any other further discussions? Hearing none, all in favor signify by aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign, and carried.